Scottish pop music is an eclectic landscape inhabited by musical mavericks, true pop stars, and global phenomena. There's room for everyone, from tartan addicts and shouty singers to shiny pop smilers, avant-garde activists, and indie dreamers. Most pop musicians want to hit the big time and become a star.
I advise everybody to try and be a pop star because it's a wonderful existence.
And why not? It's an attractive proposition. There's the money, the fame, the adulation, not to mention the freaky outfits and all the drugs. But there's a price to pay for all that fun stuff. In pop music, credibility is often the first casualty in the fight to get to the top. So how do you achieve that elusive goal of success? And once you've got it, can you keep your cool?
I think having success is a good thing. I think prostituting yourself for it is a bad thing.
We wanted it to be international. We wanted it to be global.
We loved the idea of taking it as far and wide as we possibly could.
Would I have preferred to have it my way and sell a tenth of what I sold? No.
There's a price to pay for worldwide massive success.
Right, it's a real treat on the programme now, and the time we've all been waiting for is it's time to welcome the Bay City Rollers!
Bye bye, baby, baby, goodbye. Bye bye, baby, bye bye.
Up until the late 70s, the most successful Scottish pop act had been the Bay City Rollers, selling their admittedly catchy tunes through a tartan prism of commercial cliche. But ironically, the most successful acts of the early 80s would be born out of that most anti-establishment and anti-commercial of movements. Punk.
Everyone will know the band Simple Minds, but actually they started as a punk band, Johnny and the Self-Abusers.
Johnny and the Self-Abusers certainly was the first local punk thing.
Actually, Edinburgh and Paisley were more sort of punk hubs, just purely because punk was notoriously banned by the Lord Provost in Glasgow.
In true punk nihilistic fashion, we recorded one single and split up the day the single came out.
When we were finishing Johnny and the Self-Abusers, we did our last ever gig in a discotheque in St. Enoch Square called the Terminal One, or the T1, as it was called. I remember the DJ came and he said, right, you're on after this record. And he said, but you've got time because it's a 12-inch single. And we said, 12? What's a 12-inch single? And he said, never mind. And I remember clear as day going up, I was standing at the side of the stage and we heard this incredible piece of music. Didn't know what it was, of course. And the piece of music we're listening to was Giorgio Moroder, Donna Summer, I Feel Love. I remember Charlie and I going like, we need to get a synthesizer.
Punk was very much a DIY form of music. It was very much about, you know, the guitars and the drums. But if we look at the synthesizer, and whilst you can, of course, create the illusion in your mind that the synthesizer is about the high end, about high techno, about pop, about pomp, it was actually, by the 70s, a relatively cheap piece of equipment, which lots of people were experimenting with. So there is an argument to be made that synthesizer is a punk medium.
Yeah.
fortune played a great hand because Charlie's girlfriend worked with Mick McNeil, who became the keyboard player in our band. I think we managed to get the only guy with a synthesizer in the whole of Glasgow, maybe the whole of Scotland.
Embracing the synthesizer was a critical turning point for Simple Minds as they set a course for commercial, albeit initially arty, success.
I liked the records when they thought they were German, you know, and I think I Travel is an amazing record.
When Simple Minds broke through in quite a big way, but on in a kind of more Berlin European style scene, that made them a big, huge dance floor hit.
As the synthesizer becomes more dominant within pop culture, you see bands like Simple Minds beginning to use that technology to create a new sound for a new generation audience.
For me, Simple Minds often don't get the credit they deserve because for at that time they were really pushing the envelope of what you could do with a rock band and building things around bass grooves and like really using really mental affected guitar sounds. They sounded like the future at the time. It was very, very exciting.
Simple Minds records show flirtations with a number of styles, the flamboyant new romantic era, and then the computer-generated sounds of Europop.
I actually really like the early Simple Minds records, but I didn't know that they used to be an art rock band because I always just remembered them as being a big stadium band. Just thought of them as being like the Scottish U2, and yeah, there's a lot more to them than that.
Whilst the esoteric synth stylings of early Simple Minds might not have had the massive chart success of their later work, which we'll come back to shortly, they did inspire a generation of post-punk bands who would also adopt the synthesizer in order to gain commercial triumph. One of the most successful of these groups was Altered Images.
If you actually look at the band in their earliest days, they had many of the characteristics of a kind of punk band. And they had this kind of mesmeric young female singer at the front of them.
Altered Images had initially been offered a recording contract by wannabe impresario Alan Horn of Glasgow independent label Postcard Records, but they turned him down, deciding instead to sign with a major record company based in London.
We said no, thank you. I mean, everybody loved the Postcard thing and wanted to be part of it, but you know, we were thinking Postcard, epic. We always loved the idea of taking it as far and wide as we possibly could. And I think that when a major record label who signed Michael Jackson and ABBA are interested in you, you're going to go, yeah, let's go with that.
To go to London or not, I think it's been something that's kind of been a question mark for many, many great bands. Some of them want to go to London to prove that they're good enough on a global stage and to sell and to work with a record company that can get them visibility and get them into the markets and all the rest of it, and break away sometimes even from the stranglehold that independence, indie, can have on the imagination.
But it soon became clear that in order to hit the big time, Altered Images would have to change their sound to make it more marketable. So, like their heroes Simple Minds, they turned to the synthesizer.
Epic, who we were saying to, decided that the first album lacked a little bit of commercialism that was they really needed to push us to where we wanted to be, and actually we agreed with them.
In order to give the band the commercial edge they needed, the record company drafted in the hot producer of the moment, Martin Rushent. He had just redefined the Human League sound, propelling Don't You Want Me to number one in 1981.
Matt Lusher was great because he just got tail end of Dare. He did the Human League Dare, so that was like amazing. And he had this big massive studios in Berkshire, and so we went down there and he had the Lindrum. I mean, it was like, wow, this unbelievable Lindrum drum machine.
And I think he really kind of formulated our sound a bit. He took us somewhere else because his production was so... You knew a Martin Rushent record, you know, it was like you really knew by the first four bars of a song, you'd go, Martin Rushent produced that.
How much of Altered Image's success do you feel is attributable to working with Martin?
Shall we say a modest 99%?
A modest 99%. What's she like to work with, Martin?
Wonderful.
He was a big influence on the music, and that gave us that sort of commercial edge that we really needed to get into the charts.
I hope that we could make some slightly more commercial sounding records together, which we tried to do. Making the album turned into a lot of fun. We had a wonderful time doing it, and it's been a tremendous success.
Rushent's magic touch worked a treat. One of their first efforts, Happy Birthday, got to number two in the charts, selling over a quarter of a million copies when it was released in 1981.
Happy Birthday came out. This had all the kind of modernity of new forms of pop music. And of course, it was tailor-made for things like Top of the Pops.
It was Claire's obvious, you know, capacity for happiness that seemed to be, you know, you could not suppress it. You couldn't fail to look at that and listen to her and not feel joy.
It's much harder to write a happy song than it is to write a sad song. It's a piece of piss to write a sad song. When you're sad, you're like, oh, where's my guitar? You're happy, you're like, pop! Not writing songs.
It's really hard to do happy well, and Altered Image just bursts, you know, onto the scene, just the absolute epitome of joy. I think, whoa, where'd that come from? Get away.
There was something about Altered Images that managed to pull off one of the hardest things to do in pop music. Sing about happiness and remain credible.
Claire's talent for believable glee was one ingredient of Altered Images' success. But another was access to the London music industry machine. But they weren't the only ones looking south for their big break. One of their contemporaries who shared their desire to make it on the London scene were consummate outsiders, the Associates.
We had to go through London because that's where we wanted to be. We didn't want to really be in Glasgow or Edinburgh. We wanted to have an adventure.
My girlfriend at the time went, oh, this band, The Associates, the greatest thing ever. And I said, what do you mean the greatest thing ever? The better news, aye. I've got boots in old place.
Disregards a cold place. Billy McKenzie not only looked good, he dressed well.
There was a distinct kind of bohemian chic about him. I think he looked like $1 million. I thought that he was Scotland's true pop star.
The Associates' biggest commercial success came with the release of their unique pop masterpiece, Party Fears 2. Reaching number 9 in the UK charts, it took the band to the promised land of Top of the Pops. Cup, please
don't stop saying that. One Thursday evening, tuning into Top of the Pops, listening to the absolute drivel of what Top of the Pops, and this band appeared, The Associates.
Party Fears 2 comes out, and you're like, where did that come from? They looked great, they sounded great, they were totally unique, they sounded like unlike anyone else.
And we just locked onto it. Everyone, I think it was a jaw-dropping moment for the whole country. It was like, who is this?
I remember hearing Party Fears 2 for the first time and thinking, what is that? It was a Scottish bohemian rhapsody.
It's got one of the most unusual hooks in that piano line. Hooks like that don't come along very often. You know, and when we looked at each other and said, ooh, what are we going to do with that?
You felt that if a single like Party Fears 2, which was so bizarre in many ways, could be so commercially successful, anything goes. It was a real signal point that you could actually just express yourself in any way you wanted and people would still buy it. There was a real feeling then that nobody wanted to consume manufactured pop anymore. They were much more interested in things that were happening around the fringes. And suddenly the fringes became commercially successful. And I think that was quite a big moment.
Whilst the Associates and Altered Images had been in the vanguard of monetizing musical weirdness, their synthy compatriots, Simple Minds, were about to take commercial success to the next level.
We wanted to take it around the world. We wanted it to be international. We wanted it to be global.
Breaking America is one of the holy grails of pop music across decades. This is globally the most important market in the world, because if something goes to number one in America, as a consequence of that, it sells heavily in Latin America. It then moves, of course, to Europe if it's not been released there before. And of course, it goes out there to Japan and to other and to the Chinese market and whatever. If you break it in America, you're breaking it globally in the world.
The difficulty was in America that there's not just one single radio station. So in order to make any impact at all, you have to tour and tour and tour and tour.
But whilst the Minds hammered the touring circuit in America, it became clear that they had to change their sound again.
The venues we're playing were starting to get bigger. I mean, we were getting into the biggest venues. And I remember thinking, if this is where we're going, wouldn't it be great to have a few things that really worked? Lo and behold, a song like Waterfront comes on.
It's the right balance between the art rock, the avant-garde of earlier Simple Minds, and the bigger stadium rock sound that was just happening for the band. And Waterfront is almost the song which kind of has a foot in both camps. It brought their older fan base and the kind of post-punk fan base with them, but also started opening the band up to a newer, more sort of chart-friendly audience.
Simple Minds debuted this new stadium-sized sound on the album Sparkle in the Rain, which gave the band their first major commercial breakthrough success. It went straight to number one in the UK charts and was a hit around the world.
even imagine a band now becoming a huge stadium band on their fifth record. I mean, you'd be dropped if you didn't have enough Twitter followers after the first 10 seconds of your single. And then that's that.
There's not many, many bands that have actually made it so big in America. Some have done it for a period of time, but very few have made it to number one in the American charts and stayed there for some time. Simple Minds did, of course, with Don't You Forget About Me.
But whilst Don't You Forget About Me would prove to be the zenith of their success, giving them the coveted American number one chart spot, it would also alienate fans who really liked their earlier stuff. Won't you come see about me? I'll
be alone, dancing, you know it, baby. What's the big film that they did? The Breakfast Club. And suddenly you're like, what? Everything inside
and out. That was the slightly Elvis Vegas moment for me, you know, or Elton John Liberace moment, and I think you're still geniuses, but I'd kind of drop back from listening to them at that point. When the light gets in your heart, baby,
don't you forget about me. I think people get very suspicious when you change your music for financial gain, you know. I think a lot of people in the 1980s did that, and I actually think that there was more derision than some of the music itself probably deserved. There's actually a lot of people that got really commercial but still made really good records. They were just really good commercial records. Rain keeps falling down,
down, down. Much of the bands that had emerged out of Glasgow in the era of Simple Minds had kind of come either from the punk scene or from kind of synth pop and whatever. And they tended to be people that were happier in small venues, in kind of indie-style clubs. And the idea of going out there and doing the American thing and appearing in big rock stadia to 70,000 people and whatever was slightly alien to the Scottish independent music scene. And so therefore, it kind of exaggerated a perception that Simple Minds had done something that was illegal almost.
To go and consciously try and break America was frowned on. You know, it was like, oh, you're selling out to America, and we thought, to hell with that. I'll be alone,
dancing, you know it, baby. They had the sheer bloody brass neck to go and do it, which is what separates often people who become very successful and people who don't in music. I think you've got to have strong self-belief, and you've got to be willing to walk through walls for what you believe in.
More power to them. I mean, perhaps they would not have continued making music to this day if they hadn't had that level of success.
The massive success of Simple Minds in America and the chart impact that acts like The Associates and Altered Images had piqued the interest of the big-time London music industry. They saw the hits and the money rolling in and decided that Scotland might be a profitable seam to mine. So the industry's A&R execs packed their coke and fancy trousers and flew up to Glasgow en masse to find the next big thing.
The record industry was awash with money, and they signed an awful lot of bands at that time.
Every weekend, A&R men from every major London record company would come up, and sometimes from America, would come up to Glasgow, stay the weekend, go and see a bunch of gigs.
Explain. They used to fly in their Learjets into Glasgow Airport, you know, get their huge limos, and they would come along to the worst rehearsal studios you've ever seen in your life.
Bars and the clubs were full of, you know, London geezers up, you know, sort of taking notes, taking drugs and taking notes, signing people up.
And I mean, Thursday night in Glasgow was always A&R night. People were kind of tripping over each other. I mean, literally tripping over each other to find acts and
And I think there was a sense in which once you've discovered one, there must be a whole lot of other acts in Scotland.
Every A&R man in London is at this gig. So someone's going to sign them.
And that lasted for about 3 or 4 years. And you would have bands that would literally just form. A management company would put a band together because that guy could play bass, that guy was pretty, and that guy could play drums. And they would demo their first three songs and they would sign a record deal for 100 grand. You know, they got 100 grand advance. It was pretty nuts.
But it wasn't just random chancers getting their big break. This A&R boom resulted in a kind of pop enlightenment in Scotland, out of which grew some of the most successful acts of the 80s. And whilst they set their sights on commercial victory, they were also committed to writing songs that reflected the social issues of the time.
I think at the time there was a feeling that not just in Scotland but other parts of the UK there was certainly people writing about things that were maybe of a bit more substance, and it reflected the time.
I think it's important if you're going to be standing up and singing a song, you actually write about something that bothers you or affects you in some way.
1987, there was a rash of records that came out by, you know, The Proclaimers, Hue and Cry, Deacon Blue, Wet, Wet, Wet. And although these are very, very different artists, I mean, radically different artists, these records all shared something. These songwriters wanted to write about something over and above mere glossy pop music.
One of the glossiest of these glossy pop bands was Clyde Banks' own Wet, Wet, Wet.
Wishing I Was Lucky had the characteristics of quite a lot of songs of that period of time. There was a kind of Thatcherite recognition of job loss in Britain at the time, and the idea of Wishing I Was Lucky was the desire to actually be in full-time employment from a band in Clyde Banks, so it's actually cleverly quite a political song.
The pop sheen is always the shiny front, but behind it there's a message about unemployment, about coming from the dark ages of Clyde Bank, the deprivation, the shutdown factories, and it's a message of hope about the fact that the dark days are over.
In a way, it kind of goes under the radar a bit because you think it's just a happy jog-along song, you know. And I think that's a good way to get people.
There was something pretty fresh about that. You couldn't help admitting that, you know, even though they had these grins from ear to ear and obviously they'd been given a rather large advance from somebody, they were still... that was a great tune, you know, and you couldn't help your kind of local municipal pride swelling.
The song was an instant hit, shooting to number 6 in the UK singles chart the week it was released. For the Wets, it meant instant fame. But it also meant an instant credibility gap.
They weren't like that before, you know, they had a kind of real sense of soul about them. And that first single was so poppy, and the video was so poppy, and it was almost, you know, from a musician's point of view, almost kind of go, oh, you're much more than that. And they probably thought that at the time as well. At the same time, you think, well, actually, you've got a single in the charts.
We went from front covers of NME, Melody Maker, to smash hits in the space of 4 weeks. We went from the darlings of Blue Eyed Soul to absolute pop mayhem in the space of 4 weeks.
This success was something the Wets embraced wholeheartedly. There was no hand-wringing about lost artistic integrity here.
We grabbed it with both hands because, remember, Wet Wet came from the dole. We came from unemployment, and any success was great to us. And yes, For two shiny years, we were the Beatles, we were the Monkees, we were being chased down the street, we were on everyone's bedroom wall, and it was glorious.
Basically, when you start, when your clothes start getting stolen off the washing line, you know that there's something strange happening.
We're just sort of happy that things have happened for us and that, you know.
The thing that made it happen was really getting the single out. That's the bottom line. It took us a long time, but it got out, people heard it and appreciated it.
There was a jealousy, yes, but there was a real pride that they were Scottish in the charts doing what they're doing.
He's beautiful!
Probably because of what they were doing and because of that interest, you know, in the wake of that, it probably did us a whole lot of good as well. There's a man I meet,
walks up our street. Just like their pals the Wets, Deacon Blue were also imprinting social commentary onto their shiny pop surface. And litter off the gutter, puts it in a bag, and never thinks to mutter. And he packs his lunch in his sunless bag, the children call him Bogey. He never let.
If you look at Ricky Ross and Deacon Blue's dignity, that's a thing about kind of the social humanism of growing up, of having a job, of working within a profession, of having the dignity of labour, of being connected to a community that, that respects you because of your status within a working class community.
The song was really me being abroad, thinking about home. Everyone was thinking about unemployment. That was the whole thing. I mean, we were talking about it. Bands were unemployed. People were on the brew. I remember thinking what it's like to do a job that other people don't want to do. So it's become a kind of folk song in a sense for people. And the best story about Dignity is this. We did a gig about, I think it's probably about 10 years ago, and we did a gig at the Hogmanay in George Square in Glasgow, and it was absolutely frozen.
Mm, miserably cold.
Really, really cold. So we had to, we did a sound check, and it, across George Square, it was the ice was packed down, and all these guys that were obviously worked for the council were sent out on Hogmanay to chip the ice off the thing. The most miserable job you can imagine. And the wee guy just looks up off his spade and he goes, Ricky, going to do Dignity.
Dignity. I think since we're doing the gig at this council, we should definitely do that.
And I said, you know what, let's just do it. Someone had been standing on the periphery of all this, or leaning on a fence, videoed it. And they videoed the whole thing, and then you just hear a voice of the body guy go, that was fucking magic. And I just thought, that's the best version, you know? That's like, that's the, that should be the definitive YouTube version. And I'm thinking about home
and all that that means. In a way, that's kind of what the song's for, isn't it?
Yeah, totally. It was like the song had kind of gone full circle, you know?
Massive records, massive success. And I think they did it with integrity as well. The substance of the music's what matters. And if you got something to say, because if you've not got anything to say, you get found out immediately, you know. Those guys got something to say and they did.
And I think the best of all of those songs is Letter from America by The Proclaimers. When you go,
I remember first seeing them on the tube and just, I loved their voices, I loved the Scottish accent, I loved they were singing about Scotland and political situation in Scotland and Thatcher's Britain. I thought they were really unique.
In the 90s, our old pals Wet 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 would crank it up a notch, reaching a level of chart success unsurpassed by any other British band, even to this day.
We'd done a cover version for a film called Four Weddings and a Funeral. And the cover version was a song by the Troggs. I feel it in my fingers, I feel it in my toes. Well, love is all around me. We recorded it in 3 days. We thought it was a B-side. And the record companies kind of phoned us and went, no, I think we should release this. This kind of works all right. OK, it's lovely. That's lovely. And we put it out and it became a monster. I feel it in my fingers, I feel it in my toes.
there's something about the relationship between the film and the song that became a huge, huge success. So the stronger the film got, the stronger the record became. It's written on the wind. And there was this kind of configuration of two forms of culture, pop music and popular cinema, that just seemed to feed off each other and feed off each other. If you really love me, come on and let it show. It was ridiculous amount of times that it was at number one. Is it 15 or something weeks? Feel it in my fingers. I feel it in my soul. And it just seemed relentless. You know I love you. People were willing them to be knocked off the top spot. But the more they willed, the more this record was getting played, and it just became ubiquitous.
You could not turn on the radio at that time without hearing that song. And I've just found out recently that the reason it stopped being number one and stopped existing as a single in the shops is because Marty Pello himself withdrew it. I think he maybe was falling on his sword for the sake of the sanity of the British public, to be honest.
We found that the success from Love Is All Around was so overwhelming and so life-changing that it actually, in a way, sowed the seeds of Wet Wet Wet's destruction. Marty's fame increased and the band become the musicians behind him, and that's not a healthy place. When you're four guys standing in a line of four equals and one person starts getting ahead, it really becomes a very difficult situation.
We want to be seen as a band, so if I flip out and start thinking, hey, I'm the bee's knees, then Tommy will just punch me.
It took its toll. There's a price to pay for worldwide massive success.
But one of Wet Wet Wet's contemporaries who have managed to avoid paying this price are soulful hitmakers Texas.
Texas, curiously enough, you could almost frame them into any of the kind of decades, 80s, 90s, and now. And that maybe points to one of their greatest ever achievements, longevity. I mean, Texas are the great survivors.
I think you produce records that people want to hear. They've sustained a level of commercial success that is unbelievable, really.
Texas grew out of the same scene as Wet 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 and Deacon Blue, getting their first hit with 1989's I Don't Want a Lover. But after this initial high, their fortunes had begun to wane.
We were kind of like kicked to the curb, and we just knuckled down and went and wrote White on Blonde. Yeah, that's when it went all very big. It's like, we're shifting millions of records.
Ian Amman was telling us about they had those kind of like meetings, record company meetings, and they said the Wet and Blonde was expected to sell 100,000 records in the first year, no, for the whole campaign. And we sold that in the first day.
One of the real kind of challenges of longevity is how you keep returning again and again and again, seeming to be doing something new and original, but at the same time maintaining a deep relationship with your core audience.
There will be an end to it at some point, and when that comes, it comes. And I'm really accepting of that. But it just keeps going. Thank God.
The success enjoyed by the bands that grew out of the 80s pop scene was made possible by a music industry that could almost print money. CDs were king and sold by the truckload. The media was smaller and more targeted. And record companies controlled the economics of it all completely. It seemed huge, indestructible, and artistically bankrupt, and as such, was ripe for satire.
This is Radio Freedom.
Enter the KLF.
KLF were a great marriage of kind of punk art and music and slightly dubious sense of humours, you know, and that's what was great about them.
I absolutely loved the KLF. They were bonkers. The concept at the time of not being corporate shills, that was a great concept. Justified ancient liberation, Zulu, got to teach and everything you learn. No point to the fact that
time is eternal. They'd made these like cult records that were huge underground club anthems. And then they turned these underground cult records into pop hits. They had cheesy raps. They literally had this formula of everything you can imagine. They threw everything but the kitchen sink at these records.
The KLF claimed to literally have the formula to make chart hits. Phil Drummond wrote a book called The Manual about how to produce a song designed purely to create commercial success.
This is the new thing from the cranial recesses of Bill Drummond, The Manual, How to Have a Number One the Easy Way.
If you don't get a number one, we will refund the price of the book.
They were parodying, you know, the worst successes of the music industry, obviously.
KLF, they were pop mavericks. People that were oppositional to pop itself. People that kind of almost hated the idea that they were in the pop industry. There was something slightly, I don't know, slightly dirty about it.
Bill Drummond's formula for success actually worked, at least for the KLF. They quickly became the biggest selling singles act in this universe.
The KLF were like total and utter heroes, and the way that they completely played with people's expectations of what a successful band should be, said a lot, they totally played with the way that the music industry should be. So they were hugely inspirational on all sorts of levels beyond just the music that they made.
When I saw them on things like Top of the Pops, and he would be dressed as giant ice cream cones, or he'd have like these robes on with big horns coming out of them and things, I was like, thank goodness for like people like this. It's not boring.
It was the most exciting thing ever, and the most ridiculous thing, and they would up the ante every time and become more over the top and more ridiculous. And then the videos, there's a video to What Time Is Love America. What time is love? What time is love? What time is love? Who knows how much money they spent on that, where there's, they must have spent hundreds of thousands of pounds building this boat.
What? You know, being confused is a very underrated thing. The final chapter, copacetic poetry. So surreal. It's incredibly moving. It's beautiful. You know, when you watch your video and you're like, it's so absurd. Why am I moved by this? That's part of the magic of music and art. What time is love?
One of the most controversial things the KLF did during a career built on doing controversial things involved taking £1 million of their profits from record sales to the remote Scottish island of Jura to perform their biggest stunt yet.
There you go. KLF's account, £1 million.
Withdrawn.
To be honest, I all soured when they burnt that money.
I just couldn't abide that.
As someone at that point that was living in abject poverty, I had very mixed feelings about it, but I thought it was an incredible gesture. Of course, we don't know, and we will probably never know whether they did actually burn the £1 million.
And I know loads of people will give me shit for this, but I think it's an amazing, I think it's modern philosophy in action and a great art statement as well.
And it actually just shows you what's happened to the music industry, the idea of a band like the KLF getting £1 million. That's probably more amazing than them burning it.
Was it the 90s they did it?
Yeah.
That actually sums up the 90s, when there's so much money around that you think it's going to be endless. I bet you they're regretting it now.
I think one of them carries around, I wish I hadn't burnt that £1 million on a bit of paper in his wallet.
Every day you wake up and go, oh God, yeah, okay, I've just burnt £1 million. Everybody, nobody thinks it's good. Everybody just thinks it's a complete waste of time. You know, everybody wants to know why you did it, and you can't tell them why you did it because you don't know why you did it.
I don't believe for a minute that they burned that £1 million on Jura. I kind of know they didn't.
A friend of mine swept out the wee bothy where they burnt the money on Jura, so I know they definitely did it.
I mean, it's probably the greatest stunt in the history of pop music.
The KLF did something truly unprecedented in that through being nakedly cynical and lacking in integrity, they somehow created one of the most honest representations of the music industry in history. And as such, have earned their enduring credibility. Ironic indeed. This tension between credibility and commercial success is perhaps most acutely felt in the independent music world. And no one knows this better than Primal Scream.
Primal Scream sort of started as a kind of scrappy indie band. They smartened up a little bit on their first album, Sonic Flower Groove, which was very birdsy, chiming guitars. And they went a bit more rocking on the second album. They were obviously listening to Detroit rock and roll, such as The Stooges and the MC5. I'm not sure people were ready for either the first album or the second album, but when they engaged with the rave scene, and particularly Andrew Weatherall, that's when they hit gold.
The band were, you know, like really in the throes of like ecstasy and acid house. So there was never a way that we could go in for 6 weeks and record an album. So it was like a track every 2 weeks, you know, between partying. Andy took it away to a little studio in Walthamstow and he didn't want to fuck with the track and we kept saying, just fuck it up, and he did, and Loaded was born.
It was quite radical at the time to have a DJ or a dance music producer produce an album for a band.
For the evolution of the DJ as a producer, there were bands in Scotland who were at the cutting edge of that.
Loaded was a hit, going straight into the top 20 and setting the tone for the rest of the album.
When I think of the album Screamadelica, I have kind of very, very warm thoughts about it. It's almost, for me, the great healer. There's something about this record that brought together the warring factions that just didn't really quite like each other. It was dance music, it was very aware of the kind of acid underground rave scene, it had that kind of synth beat to it, but at the same time, there was the kind of coruscating guitar of the indie rock scene and all the rest of it. And it was universally the number one album of the week, and peace broke out.
A good test of that is if you put on Screamadelica in a club, would people dance to it? And they absolutely would.
I think there would have been some people who were suspicious of indie bands playing with dance beats. Of course, there's always purists. It's people saying, oh, you're a sellout, you're getting dancey. And there was also a cliche at the time, there's always been a dance element to our music, when there clearly wasn't for a lot of bands. And you could hear the fakes, but there were the people who genuinely connected with house music and with club culture, and I think Primal Scream were definitely one of those.
With Screamadelica, Primal Scream sought out a change in their sound, which in turn led to commercial success. But what happens when that change is imposed upon you? Her face is a map of the world, is a map of the world. You can see she's a beautiful girl, she's a beautiful girl. When Katie Tunstall's debut album, Eye to the Telescope, was being finished, she faced a clear choice between her indie sensibilities and commercial viability.
I was so inexperienced and I just didn't get told that the record was being mixed. So it got mixed without me knowing where it was being mixed or who it was being mixed by. This is what I wanna be, and I got given the record back and I was like, whoa, you guys have like ironed this. It wasn't what I necessarily wanted to sound like. And so there was a really difficult relationship for me with how it sounded. And then it bloody sold like four or five million copies. Would I have preferred to have it my way and sell a tenth of what I sold? No. I think it was as successful as it was because it was made to sound a bit more commercial.
Katie Tunstall was part of a glut of Scottish pop acts that made it big on the world stage in the 90s and noughties. Glasgow indie legends Belle and Sebastian became a global phenomenon, inspiring hipsters from Argentina to Ayrshire. Speaking of Ayrshire, Kilmarnock expats Biffy Clyro have taken their brand of stadium-filling melodic rock around the planet. Cool Kids Franz Ferdinand went from playing freezing arty parties in Glasgow to sell out world tours in a matter of months. And an ex-shelf stacker from Dumfries has gone from being this guy to this guy. Calvin Harris, the most successful male solo act on the face of the earth. We fell in love. But a group that epitomised what it means to be a successful Scottish band are synth popsters Chvrches.
I guess if you wanted to bring the story fully up to date, then the group that probably pulls so many of these different threads together would be Chvrches. There are tiny cracks of light underneath me and you say I got it wrong. You have the charismatic lead singer. This return back to the kind of 70s and 80s synth pop. They also have Cracked America. And you look at them and you think, well, they've just about got everything.
I heard that and immediately I said, I love that. You know, it really spoke to me, and that doesn't happen a lot, because I'm a fussy bugger. And you have best belief that you're gonna build what I don't need. And
I know I need to feel relief. They have those like big soaring melodies, they have those catchy riffs, it's quite playful, it has like a kind of in-the-know humour about it that still manages to feel very relatable. I know I need to feel release. Take
care to tell it just as it was. Take care to tell on me for the ball.
It's almost mathematical precision pop where everything in that song is geared towards making it an enriching, exciting and joyful listen. That's what pop music should be.
They've got that balance between their art house indie roots and an overt love of commerciality and hit pop songwriting, which they do brilliantly. You don't have top 10 albums in 20, 30 countries across the world unless you're doing something right. I will wipe the salt off from my skin
and I'll admit that I got it wrong. What they are doing should be wholeheartedly applauded and encouraged. So good for us. So good for us all, you know? So long may that kind of attitude continue.
Scottish pop has come a long way since the darkly tartan days of the 70s. Franz Ferdinand are packing out arenas. Chvrches are taking over America. And the old guard are still going strong. Armed with synths, social commentary, and stadium-sized tunes, many of these artists managed to navigate the shallow money trench of the music industry while retaining their credibility. And others burned brightly before collapsing under the weight of it all. But one thing is universal. They were all top of the pops.